Amen. Thank you, Amelia, for that wonderful prelude music. Good morning. God is good. And all the time. Indeed it is. It's a wonderful day to be in worship together. Our youth are leading our service this morning. We're so grateful for our youth leading us. They say that our youth is the church of tomorrow. I say they're also the church of today, being wonderful examples for all of us to that faithful walk with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Our youth, and in fact our adult Sunday schools, have been studying Jesus' Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 5. Here now our introit, Christ Be Our Light.
Good morning.
Good morning.
God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
We welcome you to worship today. We're glad you are joining us, whether in person or by live stream. We hope this service is a blessing to you in some way. Once a month, we, the youth of Bridgeport United Methodist Church, will be leading, singing, and serving in worship in various ways. We are grateful to be a part of this church of faith and thank all of you for supporting us in our faith journey. We are also glad to be a part of a Matthew 25 church, a community of faith that follows Jesus rather than reaching out to the least, the last, the lonely, and the left out. Let us open our hearts and minds to receive what God has for us in this place.
Please stand as you are able and join me in this morning's call to worship. The grace of God abounds for us all. The Lord has offered his mercy and love, even to us. We come together to worship in spirit and in truth. Our God is a great God, full of majesty and honor. Let us sing about the Lord of our salvation. Let us remain standing and sing together, God of Grace and God of Glory, found on page 577 of our United Methodist hymnals.
Thank you. Let us pray. Lord, you have invited us to your house today, and we thank you. We are humbled by your invitation, and we pray that you will receive the offering of praise and thanksgiving that we make in this place. Your presence surrounds us every day, and we see your many blessings unfold all around us. Your love is so great and amazing, and your grace is able to meet our every need. We thank you for our families and for our church family. We being able to be a part of this community of faith that truly serve Christ is a true blessing, and we pray that you will always show us the way to do your will and follow your way. We praise you for the giving your Son for us, and we ask that you increase our trust in him, so that both our words and our deeds would represent him. We offer this prayer in his holy name, even as we pray together the prayer that he taught us when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Good morning. My name is Regan Fitzpatrick, and my family and I have been members of this church since 1989, and I am a fourth-generation member. We have been involved in worship committee, youth group, adult and youth choir, VUMC men's, preschool, joyful noise, missions, and much more. We give God praise for the opportunity to grow in our faith here and to live our faith each day. We hope that you will join us in regular worship service through the many opportunities that are offered here. Please consider returning to the Lord a portion of what he has given you so that your church can stay strong in mission. For example, did you know that our regular giving supports hunger projects and missionaries all around the world? Our giving truly helps those in both great need locally and globally. All of us are called to give God's work. You can make your donation using our e-giving tab on the website, or by mailing in your donation, or by giving your person in by giving your donation in person in the baskets at the entrances. Also, please stay connected to your church by visiting the website and following us on our various social media platforms. Thank you for all your faithfulness.
Mine. I'm going to shine. This little light of mine. We affirm our faith using creeds and promises based in the Bible. This morning, our affirmation of faith comes to us from Romans 8. In these verses, the Apostle Paul reminds us of a great promise concerning the love that God has for us. Join with me in this affirmation. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? No. In all things, we are more than conquerors through the one who loved us. We are sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus.
Please stand as you are able for our scripture reading. This morning, the reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 9. And so, brothers and sisters, I could not speak to you as spiritual people, but rather as fleshly, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, but you were not ready for solid food. Even now you are still not ready, for you are still fleshly. For as long as there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not fleshly and behaving according to human inclinations? For when one says, I belong to Paul, and another, I belong to Apollos, are you not all too human? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom came to believe as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. The one who plants and the one who waters have one purpose, and each will receive wages according to their own labor. For we are God's co-workers, working together. You are God's field, God's building.
Seated. As you know, I am bivocational, meaning I have a career outside of the church. Really, I don't see the church as some second career or job. God called me to share my testimony and witness to what God did in my life and the life of my family. You see, He pulled me out of a miry pit and set me on solid ground, restoring my marriage, my family, and having a generational impact on our house. I don't say any of that to puff up, because in fact, our family still encounters many of the challenges that families face, especially with adolescent children in the house. But God indeed lifted me up and called my family to share. In my other vocation that I have, I've got these amazing co-workers. They are truly rock stars in their respective areas, from sales to support to administrative duties, and I can feel Kim and Jennifer looking at me now. Well, I've got amazing co-workers here too. Your ministerial staff, your administrative staff here at the church are absolute rock stars when it comes to making this happen, bringing us all together so that we can worship the Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. So that's what we're called, though, to hear from Paul today in his letter to the church of Corinth. He is telling us today, well, first he says, right, to grow up, to set aside selfish ambitions or worldly affiliations. But then he says to be unified with Christ. He calls us to grow up, but then to come alongside Him, be a co-worker with Jesus Christ. Now that sounds like a co-worker from heaven. Indeed, the Lord is calling us to come and do the kingdom's work with Him, to not be spectators of what He's doing in our world, but to come alongside Him and work with Him, to be the field, to be the building, the scripture says. In other words, to be the vessel through which Christ can operate in our world. I love that image of the co-worker that Paul uses, saying we are God's co-workers. That is indeed, again, a co-worker from heaven. As God's co-workers, what can we do? Well, first, we can focus on the important work before us. But the scripture we just heard tells us first we need to mature in our faith. We must grow up. I remember as a child, and maybe some of these children think the same way, I remember we just want to grow up, right? We hunger to become teenagers, to gain that independence, maybe get a cell phone, you know, to obtain a driver's license, to become adults, to work and earn money and do the things that we want to do. Mom and Dad can't hold me down anymore. In the same way, I think there are many in our church who hunger to grow, right? They want to gain a deeper awareness of Christ's truths in their lives, a stronger faith for living, a maturity in their lives, and that hunger is commendable. Spiritual growth is important. We heard it here in this letter to the church of Corinth that we must grow up. I'm afraid to say I think many in our church and in the community of faith as a whole globally, maybe we're missing a little bit of that hungry spirit to learn and to grow. Instead of just attending and going home to our normal way of life, we are called to allow God to prune us and shape us and form us into who He is calling us to be. Paul's letter indeed offers some sharp criticism. Now, I'd like to read a portion of that scripture today from the Message translation. Some of you may read or study from the Message. I want to read and forgive the graphic nature of this first few verses here from the Message. Hear this. But for right now, friends, I'm completely frustrated by your unspiritual dealings with each other and with God. You're acting like infants in relation to Christ, capable of nothing much more than nursing at the breast. Well then, I'll nurse you, since you don't seem capable of anything more. As long as you grab for what makes you feel good or makes you look important, are you really different than a babe at the breast, content only when everything's going your way? When one of you says, I'm on Paul's side, and another says, I'm for Apollos, aren't you being totally childish? That's a pretty harsh, straightforward translation of that passage. Krista and I saw it recently posted somewhere. It said, if the Apostle Paul were alive today, he'd be writing us a letter. Paul's letter to the Galatians was to stop clinging to old law-based faith, to the Thessalonians, the importance of Christian living and abandoning contentious rhetoric, to the Corinthians here about distractions that can be found even in the church, certainly in society, and our greater task to living out a life of faith. He wrote to the Romans about new life that comes with Christ. Philemon, Colossians, Ephesians, all those books that Paul wrote, many of them were letters of correction, also letters of encouragement. Maybe if Paul were writing us a letter today, I guarantee you he would have some correction for us. But he also gives us the encouragement, because God, indeed, He has important work for us to do, work that calls us to be timely and urgent in our listening to God's direction, to mature in our faith, to be who He's calling us to be, so that we can indeed be the building, be the field, be the vessel through which Christ is calling us to be. Yes, I think we'd get a letter today. What would Paul tell us? I imagine part of it would tell us to focus on the eternal faith matters and to share our faith. I'm sure you guys have seen the videos, right, where people get new glasses and they're colorblind, and they get these new glasses that allow them to see color, and these vibrant pictures come in and they're just amazed at the colors that they were missing their whole life. Now they can see those colors. Or similarly, maybe you've seen those videos where a young child gets the final touches on their cochlear implants and they hear their mother's voice for the first time. I don't know about you, but I have a hard time keeping a dry eye in those videos. I know it's not just me. But I think about our culture, and I think about our lives, and we get so caught up in the political things, the racial things, the sexual things, the financial things, that the real voice we need to hear, the real color we need to see, it fades away. We become blind and deaf to the real ministry opportunities that we're called to. We miss the grandmother that is among us raising her grandchildren in the wake of addiction. We miss the children flowing in and out of the foster system and the court systems, right? We miss our coworker from heaven waving us over to help him, to be in service to him, to love and to share the good news of reconciliation, of hope, of healing. We become blinded and hard of hearing to those opportunities when we focus on all the worldly matters that are around us. But Christ has the answer for us. A focus on Christ. He has a new vision that we need. He has the new hearing that we long for. When we focus on His ways for our lives, we begin to see clearly and hear clearly, and we can live out our lives for Christ, focusing on the important work that is before us. Secondly, as God's co-workers, we can follow God's lead. When we allow God to lead us, we can follow. But being prepared to witness to what He's done in our lives when those opportunities arise, right? We're being shaped and formed to share this good news, not to hold it for ourselves. I read a story recently where a man was walking through the park. He was whistling choir songs, as he often did. This man participated with his church in choir on Sundays and on the weekends, and his regular job during the week, he was a custodian at a hospital. So one day he's walking and whistling in the park, and a man came up to him, and the stranger asked him, "Where do you work?" Taken back a little bit, the man went to move around him, wondering what was the motive of this stranger asking him where he worked. But that stranger shouted as he walked by, "You work at Memorial Hospital, don't you?" The man was shocked. How did this guy know where he worked? Intrigue took over, and so the man answered, "Yes, but how on earth did you know that? What's this about?" At that time, a stranger embraced the man with a hug, and he wouldn't let go. He said, "I was in the hospital. I was in the ICU after a car accident. I was in all kinds of braces. I was in terrible pain. But seemingly every night, a man was singing and whistling up and down the hallways. Amazing grace, blessed assurance, it is well, how great thou art. I heard your whistling, and I knew it was you. That whistling lifted my spirits and reminded me that I wasn't alone." Here we have a man that simply whistled while he worked, conjuring up Snow White images here. The Apostle Paul in this message was emphasizing that we be the building, that we be the field, the vessel through which Christ can work. And sometimes it's just whistling the tune of our Lord in our walks to the park or in our work down the hallways. Perhaps that's a challenge we face today. We continue to wait for the Lord to show up as if it's going to be another big boom and there He is. Maybe the Lord is waiting for us to step out in faith. Maybe He's waiting for us to step into those opportunities to share the gospel message. And there He will be with us. Friends, in this life, the river is often rising, right? The rains sometimes are pouring. It makes navigating this world difficult. But I promise you, if we sing and whistle the tune of salvation through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, He comes alongside us. Our co-worker from heaven gives us the words, gives us the message to share with others in need. We can follow His lead, or we can step out and lead and be assured that Christ journeys with us. Finally, as God's co-workers, we can be accountable, or I should say, we should be accountable. By focusing on the important issues, by maturing in our faith, as the Apostle Paul calls us here, following God's lead, living leadership lifestyle, a Christian leadership lifestyle, we are living an accountable Christian life. Accountability is a difficult topic. The tricky thing about accountability is that most everyone believes they're being accountable, even when they're not. A few weeks ago, our Bible study was wrapping up. Our class has a lot of parents whose children are in our Bible school, or Sunday school, we invite you to come and join us between services. And on occasion, my wife will get to talking, and so our class might run over a little bit. And when that happens, the children that have been released from Sunday school, they congregate outside of our door there in the parlor. And they usually wait for us to finish up, and they'll come barging in looking for any leftover donuts or cookies. But on one Sunday, a few weeks ago, our class was wrapping up, and this young man came in the door. He could not contain himself. He couldn't wait until we were done. And he went over to his father, smiling ear to ear, and he said, "Dad, Dad, I get to carry the Bible." Our faithful volunteers who arrange our acolytes and our Bible bearers had asked this young man to carry the Bible that morning. "Dad, I get to carry the Bible." That's being accountable. Maybe even without even knowing it, this young man was being an example for all of us in the world, stepping into what God was leading him to do. I pray we would all have that childlike faith, accountable heart, desiring to please our Heavenly Father. When we get the chance, because we will get the chance to carry the Bible, that we would do so fully committed. The Apostle Paul says that we are to be co-workers with God, that in the ultimate co-worker from heaven, we can focus on the important matters. We can step out and be accountable Christians in this world today, showing others, being an example for others of what the life-saving, world-changing impact the Lord can have on our lives. Lord, give us the wisdom to hear and the courage to respond to your message today. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, indeed we are grateful for this opportunity to worship. You grant us this opportunity in this beautiful place to lift our voices, to witness our young people step up and lead us in worship. But Lord, outside of this place, there are many who need to hear the good news of your Son, Jesus Christ. And indeed, Lord, you are calling us to come alongside you for the important work that is before us. In a world that so desperately needs you, God, I pray that we would step up, see those opportunities you have for us, share confidently the news of your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, be with all of us today as we journey forth on this Super Bowl Sunday. Grant us joy in our hearts as we participate in activities as families. But again, Lord, as those opportunities arise where we can share the message of hope and healing and reconciliation, it would give us the courage to step into those opportunities. It's in Christ's holy name that we pray. Amen. Please know that you are certainly welcome at our altar. It's always open for prayer. If you'd like to pray for you or on behalf of others in need of prayer this day, you're welcome to come by the side aisles, or you may choose to make your place of prayer right where you are. That is fine too. Let's stand together for our closing hymn this morning, number 593, "Here I Am, Lord."
Thank you.
It's been wonderful to be in the house of the Lord with you today. Can we put our hands together for all of our youth that so amazingly led us in worship this morning? They truly are an example for us. I probably will never forget that young man saying, "I get to hold the Bible. I get to carry the Bible today." And as the Apostle Paul encouraged us today to mature and step into our faith, but to also, when we have those opportunities, to carry the Bible, which we will have, as Dr. Dan points out in his benedictions, undoubtedly this week, opportunities will arise where we get to carry the Bible. I pray that we do so in the confidence of Christ. Amen.